What's up?
Portal hypertension is a condition when pressure within the portal vein increases. Increase in portal venous pressure causes severe complications, and one of them is formation of portosystemic shunts. To understand how portosystemic shunts are formed, we have to recall Splanchnic circulation.
Go into incredibly descriptive details of the story so we all know.
Oh, yes.
Initially, left ventricle push blood into the aorta, and from aorta, blood is going into the splenic artery that supplies blood to the spleen and mesenteric arteries that supply blood to the intestine, where in mesenteric capillaries fluid exchange occurs. Then blood from the spleen by splenic vein and from the intestine by mesenteric veins is delivered to the portal vein. Portal vein drains blood into the liver, where in liver capillaries that we call sinusoids, fluid exchange occurs. After the fluid exchange in liver capillaries, blood is going into the hepatic vein, and from the hepatic vein, blood is drained into the inferior vena cava. But also we have to know that in this system we have additional vessels that remain from embryogenesis. Such vessels we call portosystemic collateral blood vessels. Back in times of embryogenesis, these vessels were crucial. They provided flow to esophageal and gastric veins. Also, they provided flow to paraumbilical and superficial epigastric veins that are located on anterior abdominal wall. And also, they provided flow to upper anal canal veins. And from these veins, blood is drained into the inferior vena cava. Adult person in normal condition practically do not use portosystemic collateral vessels, because adult person has portal vein pump line that provides flow of huge amount of blood. From inferior vena cava, blood goes into the right atrium and right ventricle of the heart, then blood crosses pulmonary circulation and goes into the left atrium and left ventricle, and from left ventricle, heart again pushes blood into the aorta, so this cycle can be repeated over and over again.
Alright, you like this.
So, let's suppose that thrombosis of portal vein occurs. The flow through portal vein into the liver sinusoids begin to decrease, because recall that flow from portal vein to liver sinusoids is equal to pressure inside the portal vein minus pressure inside the liver sinusoids divided on resistance between them. And resistance is inversely proportional to the force power of radius. So if thrombosis occurs, then radius inside the portal vein decreases. With decrease in radius, resistance increases and flow through this area decreases. So the inflow of blood to portal vein remains the same. The outflow of blood decreases due to a thrombosis. This results in accumulation of fluid proximal to the thrombosis. And initially, blood begins to accumulate at proximal regions of the portal vein. With accumulation of fluid, hydrostatic pressure inside the portal vein increases. Increase in portal venous pressure we call portal hypertension, so portal hypertension develops. With time, due to a thrombosis, even more blood begins to accumulate inside the portal vein. Increase in blood volume inside the portal vein cause increase in hydrostatic pressure, so portal hypertension becomes even more severe. And at this point, the combination of portal hypertension and the obstruction to flow into the liver sinusoids force a larger volume of blood to go into the portosystemic collateral vessels. The problem with this is that the more severe becomes portal hypertension, the higher volume of blood is going into the portosystemic collateral vessels. And the higher the volume of blood inside the vessels, the more distended they become.
I don't feel good about this. I don't feel good about this!
What do you feel good about anything?
So to explain this, there is a vessel with fluid inside it. Fluid flow occurs from left to right, and fluid has some hydrostatic pressure. And as we know, hydrostatic pressure acts in all directions. Recall that hydrostatic pressure is basically a weight of fluid that acts on a particular area. and the weight of fluid equals to mass of fluid times gravity constant. In turn, mass of fluid equals to fluid density times fluid volume. So basically, volume and hydrostatic pressure are directly related. Also, we have to know that because hydrostatic pressure acts in all directions, it determines the wall tension. Recall that wall tension is determined by the Laplace law. Laplace law states that the wall tension is equal to pressure difference between the pressure that acts from the inside of the blood vessel minus pressure that acts from the outside of blood vessel. Also, wall tension is directly proportional to the radius of the vessel and inversely proportional to the thickness of the vessel. So the higher the volume of fluid inside the vessel, the higher becomes hydrostatic pressure, and with increase in hydrostatic pressure, wall tension increase. So in this case, the inflow of blood to portosystemic collateral vessels increase. With increase in fluid inflow, more volume of fluid will be located inside the vessel. With increase in volume, hydrostatic pressure increase. With increase in hydrostatic pressure, wall tension increase. Increase in wall tension causes vessel wall distension. Because collateral vessels are veins, and veins have very high compliance, they can be very easily distended. Basically, they are like balloons. And such over-distended veins we call varices. Distension of esophageal veins and gastric veins cause formation of esophageal varices and gastric varices. Distension of paraumbilical and superficial epigastric veins cause formation of caput medusa on anterior abdominal wall. And distension of upper anal canal veins cause formation of hemorrhoids. The problem with varices is that the more distended become the veins, the higher the chance of their rupture. With time, due to a thrombosis, the higher volume of blood becomes stuck inside the portal vein. The more blood accumulate, the more severe becomes portal hypertension. And the more severe becomes portal hypertension, the more volume of fluid goes into the portosystemic collateral vessels. So with time, the inflow of blood to portosystemic shunts increase. So the volume of fluid inside the shunts increase. With increase in volume of fluid, hydrostatic pressure inside the shunts increase. With increase in hydrostatic pressure, wall tension increase. Increase in wall tension causes more severe vessel wall distension. And this time, if portal hypertension becomes even more severe, even more fluid will pass through the collateral vessels. Increase in fluid inflow causes increase in fluid volume inside them. Increase in volume of fluid causes increase in hydrostatic pressure. Increase in hydrostatic pressure causes increase in wall tension. And when wall tension reaches critical level, the force that is applied by hydrostatic pressure to blood vessel wall will prevail over the ability of the vessel wall to distend. And when this happens, critical wall tension causes rupture of the vessel wall. So the more severe becomes portal hypertension, the higher the chance that rupture of the esophageal varices will happen, and this will cause upper GI bleeding. Also, the caput medusa on anterior abdominal wall will become even more prominent, and also the higher the chance that rupture of the hemorrhoids will occur, and this will cause slower GI bleeding. So to portosystemic shunts, we include esophageal and gastric varices, caput medusa, and hemorrhoids. Among these three types of varices, esophageal varices are the most dangerous, because rupture of esophageal varices can cause severe bleeding, and the probability of variceal rupture depends on severity of the portal hypertension. The higher the pressure inside the portal vein, the higher the chance of variceal rupture, and thereby the more severe will be the blood loss. So how to deal with it?
We gotta take care of our immortal souls. You know you can't read. It's the Bible, you get credit for trying.
To prevent rupture of esophageal varices, we have to decrease the size of the varices. To decrease their size, we have to decrease the volume of blood that incomes to shunts from portal vein. Thereby, we need to decrease the volume of blood inside the portal vein. And because with decreasing volume of blood, the pressure inside the portal vein decreases, we see that our goal here is to correct portal hypertension. Because with decreasing portal hypertension, the size of the varices will decrease. The major factor that determines the pressure inside the portal vein is the income of blood from mesenteric blood vessels. So to decrease blood volume inside the portal vein, we have to decrease the income of blood from mesenteric vessels into the portal vein. And we have two groups of medications that can provide decrease in portal venous pressure by decrease in income of blood from mesenteric blood vessels. It's octreotide and non-selective beta blockers.
Everyone stay calm, we are taking over the ship.
Aye, avast!
This ship cannot be crewed by two men. You'll never make it out of the bay.
Son, I'm Captain Jack Sparrow. Savvy?
To explain the mechanism of action, we have to know that blood inflow from aorta through the mesenteric blood vessels into the portal vein is directly proportional to the pressure difference between aorta and the pressure inside the portal vein and inversely proportional to resistance created by mesenteric vessels. And resistance is inversely proportional to the force power of radius of the mesenteric blood vessels. So when octreotide or non-selective beta blockers enter into the blood circulation, they cause vasoconstriction of mesenteric blood vessels. With vasoconstriction, radius of the mesenteric vessels decrease, and with decrease in radius, resistance increase. With increase in resistance, flow into the portal vein decrease. The lower the volume, the lower the hydrostatic pressure, and thereby the less severe is the portal hypertension. So first of all, these two drugs cause decrease in portal venous pressure. The lower the volume inside the portal vein, the lesser volume of blood inflow to the portosystemic collateral vessels. The lower the volume of blood in the shunts, the lesser amount of blood will income to the esophageal and gastric varices. With decrease in volume of blood inside the varices, the size of the varices will decrease, and thereby the risk of their rupture will be significantly lower. And by this we can prevent upper GI bleeding. So these two drugs cause decrease in size of the esophageal and gastric varices that can prevent bleeding. And also, with decrease in volume of blood inside the shunts, the severity of the caput medusa will decrease, and also the severity of the hemorrhoids will decrease. So as an additional effect, these two drugs cause decrease in the severity of other portosystemic shunts manifestations.
This is either madness or brilliance.
It's remarkable how often those two traits coincide.
But octreotide and non-selective beta blockers have also a significant difference.
You didn't know that?
Seriously?
Am I done here?
Son of a bitch, you know, you're really no help at all, you know that?
Hey, language!
Octreotide acts rapidly. It's a short-acting and very potent drug. And because of this, we use octreotide in case of acute variceal bleeding. So we use octreotide when the rupture of the esophageal varices already occurred. And bleeding is ongoing. So to decrease the blood loss, in this case, we use octreotide. And the major reason is that octreotide acts rapidly. So when we infuse octreotide induces vasoconstriction of mesenteric blood vessels. With mesenteric vasoconstriction, the income of blood to portal vein decreases, and thereby the income of blood to esophageal and gastric varices will decrease. The lower the volume of blood inside the varices, the lower the hydrostatic pressure that acts on variceal walls. And with decrease in hydrostatic pressure, the lower will be the volume of blood that leak out through the rupture. So infusion of octreotide decreases the blood loss, and thereby we decrease the severity of bleeding. And this greatly decreases the mortality in these patients. So the most important concept is that we use octreotide in case if rupture is already occurred and we have to limit the blood loss. so octreotide we use in case of ongoing bleeding, so it's an option for emergency. But non-selective beta blockers, as propranolol, nadolol, and carvedilol, they act slowly, but their effect lasts longer and they have a moderate potency of action. And because of this, we use non-selective beta blockers for chronic treatment. We use them to prevent bleeding. So to prevent rupture of esophageal varices in case of portal hypertension, we use non-selective beta blockers. And the reason is that they are long-lasting drugs, so they are the optimal choice for prevention. Non-selective beta blockers induce vasoconstriction of mesenteric blood vessels. With mesenteric vasoconstriction, the income of blood to portal vein decreases, and thereby the income of blood to esophageal varices will decrease. The lower the volume of blood inside the varices, the lower the hydrostatic pressure that acts on variceal walls. And with decreasing hydrostatic pressure, wall tension decreases. And the lower the wall tension, the lower the vessel wall distension, and thereby the smaller will be esophageal varices. And the lesser the distension of variceal walls, the lower the risk of rupture, and thereby the better the prognosis for patients with portal hypertension. So the major reason why we use beta blockers for prevention of esophageal varices is their long-lasting effect. So non-selective beta blockers is the optimal choice for prevention of variceal rupture.
Great. Fine. Yep. Ciao!
What's that mean?
Ciao.
It's Italian. It means food.